We're here tonight celebrating metal. I'm curious, can you articulate for you what the true spirit of metal music is?
Well, it's not Ed Sheeran, is it, to be honest? I think nowadays, we just got back from a world tour, and the only place that doesn't seem to be very metal is England, because it is literally dominated by whoever's in the charts. Like last year, I think like eight slots was Ed Sheeran. It's because people go on Spotify and they go, oh yes, it's a good, you know, soundtrack. Let's put this on again and again and again. But you go to other countries, a little more liberated, and they go, you know what, I just heard a song on the album, on whatever, like Ghost or Metallica, and they just play it. And then, you know, like we play to like thousands abroad, come over here, and it's like, oh, cool. Hello.
So do you think there's any way to change the perception in the UK?
Oh, look over there. Well, I literally don't know, but I think this whole, the whole business with Spotify and everything, if they could regulate it a little bit better. They do it with cinema. You know, the government, like, literally puts a thing on before you go to see it. Don't illegally download. And they put this massive, crashing, like, prison thing going on, you know? They don't do that with music. And I think there needs to be a little bit more legislation about how we appreciate music. Because it's not just the bands, it's record companies, it's you guys at the end of the day as well.
We're here tonight celebrating some great icons, but also some exciting new talents. Are there any particular younger performers, younger bands that you're really excited
to award to Wolves in the Throne Room? They're amazing. Mirka, I think she's playing later on. Amelie. She's amazing. Like, what she's doing is she's taking, like, this new vibe. Like, she's a metal girl. But she's doing something completely different, like, with it all. And I think it's going to open a lot of people's eyes. It's all stuff that could get in the charts. And people go, wow, that's really haunting. And then they listen to other stuff and go, bloody hell. You know? So I think, yeah, I think that's definitely the way to go. I was more embarrassed because I got dragged on stage by Manson. Not Manson the band, Marilyn Manson, the other guy. And my mum rang up today and went, oh, so you'd... Do you know Axl Rose then? Could you get me in there with him? I was like, one, no. And two, why would he fancy... This is going to be on telly. My mum would be really offended. It's like 62. I think he would fancy it. Good point. I didn't think about that. Absolutely. Anyway, yeah, we did play yesterday. When they said 12 o'clock, I thought it was midnight. I was a bit... Didn't have my glasses on or anything.
Did you expect it would be such a huge audience?
Well, I was hoping it was. I didn't expect it. I was surprised it didn't dissolve into ash.
I'm tripping out. I'm grabbing microphones and everything. It feels really nice. It's just, it's a shock, like, to be awarded for, in, like, doing what we love. Like, it's very, it's always a strange feeling. Like, oh, by the way, you do the thing you love most as a job, and by the way, have an award for it. And let alone from Metal Hammer, like, it's... We're a bunch of punk rock kids that grew up, like, and grew into the metal scene, and to have them recognise what we do as a band, to be furthering a community that is very established and has such a long legacy and a long history that's so rich, to be recognised as being doing something positive for that is pretty rad. You called me humble, so now I'm just like, if I'm humble, it's going to seem like I'm just this wanker. So it was really grad. Like, the crowd was absolutely incredible. Like, playing Download's always amazing, let alone, like, being given that slot and then walking out on stage and, like, I look to the left and I'm like, there's people so far down there that they can't see a screen or the stage and they're still here. So it was cool. It was cool.
And you're headlining tonight's awards as well. How does it feel for you? Metal Hammer is one of the... It's an institution.
It's an institution. That's the thing.
It's an institution. You're headlining the award nights.
Yeah, it's
a full production.
Yeah, they let us in with that. Yeah. It's mad,
which,
man.
Which you're also taking to Australia.
Yeah, that's it, yeah. It's nice. Like, it's really cool to be able to not have to... Well, just say not compromise on that, which is really rad. And for Hammer to be able to let us do it, like... I'm pretty sure we played in this venue like 7 years ago and they're like, no production at all. But Hammer's like, yep, burn it all. It's sweet. And like, great, bring it on.
The drum riser as well.
The drum riser's there. It's all going. That's the thing. It's cool. It's a pretty crazy thing to have to hear when we just watch Guns N' Roses play. And Ozzy Osbourne and Avenged. And like, I saw those crowds. and it's mental, and that's like it's just nuts, like, to be honest. It's really, really rad. Like, we at this point in time, this, we don't see this as like an end game, as like this is the biggest, craziest thing we're going to do or we want to do. Like, you put us on any stage and we're going to put on a show, which our goal is simply, if you know us, we'll give you something that's worth your time rocking up. If you've never heard us before, we'll give you something that's going to make you remember us, and something that matches the effort that we put into the music. And we're not going to cheap out on it. So if you want to put us on main stage, like downloading headlines, download sometime, then we're going to do it. And we'll do it right if we ever get that shot. Oh, this is just the start. We have a couple of days off here and there, but we have a tour. Like, the Reverend Cycle has just begun. So we take that to America, then we take it to Australia, and then I think we just announced UK dates. So we're coming back in February, I believe, the end of January, the start of February 2019.
Is that going to be a package? Or
it is. It is. We can't announce the other bands just yet, but trust me, it's when you see it, there will be a reaction. We're so psyched. Like, this is, it's been a long time in the making, like, this tour, and it's in the wildest rooms that I can't, like, it's an arena tour for Parkway. First time we've ever got to do that anyway, which is mental. And to put it very simply, we're going to bring it. I think if we can bring it at Download, like, yeah, wait for the headliner.
Celebrating the spirit of metal. Can you define what that is for you? I mean, particularly as a band that have kind of evolved into that community and become a part of it more and more over the years.
Individuality. That's the thing. I've always found that it is the community and the sound that embraces individuality and doesn't shy away from... takes the rose-colored glasses off life and gives you a chance to actually express, for better or worse, what you're going through. And I think, for me, that's been very, very important. And it's very important for everyone, because we don't live in a world that's always sunshine. And being able to be happy with the person you are, no matter what, and be able to have an outlet through a sonic medium, which can be very abrasive. Life can be abrasive. And that's what always, like, it's what got me into it in the first place, and I think it matters in this society to have something like that. So for me, that the spirit of metal is simply, yeah, being able to be yourself and embrace the darkness, just as, like, in the same way you embrace the light.
Of course, tonight we're celebrating one of the great icons in Aussie. What does he mean to you, and can you talk about the other icons that really personify for you what you were just talking about what metal does for people?
Dude pretty much invented heavy metal. it's very, I'm not someone that really gets starstruck, but when he walked past before, I'm literally like, this him. That's like, I wouldn't be here. No one would be here if it wasn't for Ozzy Osbourne. So for me, it's people who have always stepped outside not only the norm of what metal's been into something new and defined a new path within that, but also people that continue, like, I'm going to shout out Judas Priest, because look how long they've been doing it and still remaining relevant, still remaining, like, they release an album which sounds contemporary and still personifies everything about metal in this day and age and refuses to relent and, like, be cowed by mainstream. And everything that they've done within not only the band that they are, but the people they are, and who Rob Halford is, his approach to absolutely everything, and still championing metal. So there's a ton of, like, I don't even want to start with the new bands, because I think it's a really awesome time for metal, full stop. I really think that it seems like when the mainstream decides to cast a shadow on it, it's metal are the flowers that grow in the darkness. So, yeah.
Longevity is a hard thing, and the industry's changed even just in the last 10 years beyond all recognition. Yep. Have you got any advice for them about how to manage that side of the industry of being in a band?
Oh, Jesus. My only advice that I've given this from the day one, has simply been, do what you care about and what you love. Because, like, it's at the end of the day, music is about sincerity. And in metal more than anything. And yeah, the music industry is an industry, and it's something that we can't even predict anymore. So if you want to do something, do something because you care about it. Because at the end of the day, if you're doing something that you want to make money out of, if you're doing something that you want to make fame out of, those things come and go with the wind. But if you want to do something that will last, there's more chance of connecting someone if it's honest. And if it connects with them and you enjoy doing it, then you at least have that to hold on to. And if you don't, you're just left with you dancing for someone else. And that's very easy to see through.
You have a message for all those fans who obviously do connect with what you do and love it so very much and are with you on every step of that journey.
Thanks. That's it. It's really easy and it's every time. Thanks. Like, I'm continually floored by what we've been able to do in this band, and I'm continually humbled by the fact that people have connected with us and supported us and allowed us to do this, because it's honestly the last thing I would have ever expected in my life.
I'm a metal guitarist first, but I've like gone all these other ways in my career, and it's really interesting to be recognized by the metal community, which I don't totally feel a part of, but so it's even more interesting that they accept me and, you know, gave me this award. There's so many people that I'm standing on the shoulders of, you know, just like, I don't know, the first Metallica record I got, and Helmet and Primus and Megadeth and Carcass and Death. The Death Human record is so amazing, and there's just so many things that I didn't say tonight that I wish I could have, because I had very limited time. But I just am such a fan of riffs in general. So it's the only thing in music to me that as a guitar player sounded like a drum beat, because I wanted to be a drummer originally. My parents were like, no, you can't have a drum kit. So it was like the first time I heard riffs in music that were had such character and were so recognizable, and to me seemed like actual objects that you could think about in a three-dimensional way. It's just really cool to me to be recognized for this, so I'm really grateful. For me, I started as a painter and a sculptor, and the riff was like the first thing that seemed tangible, like something that I could understand. Solos, I've never been a fast guitar player as far as like soloing. I even approach solos from sort of like a riff or visual point of view. So I would say that like the riff to me was the first time that I was able to get excited and inspired by something that I felt like I could hold, or that I felt was like a character or something that just made sense to me. Because whenever I write a riff, I see it as an object in my head. People talk about seeing like colors and when they see notes and stuff. I'm not that kind of person. I've never heard of thinking about things like music like objects, but that's sort of what I do. And riffs are exciting to me because they sort of feel like getting in a fist fight, and they, while at the same time being like this really beautiful, like flowing thing. I would say that for me, incorporating the tremolo bar on the low notes was what really got me excited, and that was a niche that I found that separated me from other people, because I was able to sort of use the low notes and the tremolo like a trombone and create sort of a suction where you feel like the note pull down and pull back up to where that's correlated with the beat of the song. So it felt like it felt like sort of a snap up and then a pull up and a pull down, and it was, and for me that sort of rhythmic playing became synonymous with what made me excited. You know, I wanted to hear that sort of like push and pull and hear that kind of thing happening. So I just did it more and more and more and incorporated it into my melodies. And, I have to, my palm at the beginning of a tour is always really sore because I use the bar. I'm pretty much on the bar the whole time for almost every song. So it's something that a lot of people do like soloing, but for me it was always for riffs. So we haven't put out a record since 2011, and there's been one in the works for a long time, and it's really amazing that we can go do that based on our catalog and based on that we still like come out and put a live show out and get bruises every night and you know, we have never been a band to phone it in, and I'm so grateful. I'm so lucky that I can still do this for a living. It's amazing. Yeah. So far, so good. As the man said, who was falling out of the 80th story of a building on his way down to the bottom. I don't know. So far, so good. I'm not dead yet.
You say you haven't released anything since 2011. Is there anything in the pipeline at all?
Yeah. I mean, there's been a bunch of songs. Fred's been working on vocals. I've been continuing to put out records on my own, on the side, on my own label. He seems very confident that he's about to wrap it up. So maybe next year there'll be a new Limp Bizkit record. Who knows?
It's called the best album of the year. So I won for my album the best album of the year, which is not so bad, really.
Obviously, it's great to know that you officially have the best album. What does this album mean to you? Why is it this collection of songs special for you?
It means a great deal, actually, for me to win this award, because this record, it's called Marit, which means nightmares. And I wrote it as almost like an escape of this vicious cycle of nightmares and night terrors that I was in, and nothing seemed to help me or get me out of it. Therapy or nothing I could do. So writing a record about it has, in a way, set me free a little bit. So it's a very personal record to the point of my subconscious almost. So it's nice to get this recognition as well.
Tonight we celebrate metal. What does that genre mean to you? What is so special, so unique about metal?
Oh, it's a free place where you can be yourself. You can be wild and unpredictable and ugly and hysterical and just do everything you're not supposed to do, and actually get saluted for it.
I think there's a cliche that metal is a male-dominated space. Does it feel particularly special to be winning Best Album of the Year as a female performer?
Yes. In short, yes. There's not that many women on the stage, so it feels nice. But, either way, I'm a musician, and that's the most important thing. But, yeah, I'm very honored. This album, I would wake up screaming from a nightmare and write down what was on my nightstand, what had happened in my nightmare. So I certainly did not think of anybody else. But I would take my notepad at the end of the day and try to turn it into songs. But obviously it means a lot to me when I have supporters who come up to me and tell me that this process has helped them as well, because I think a lot of people suffer from their subconscious being asleep more than just your actual sleep, but it needs to wake up, and you need to go back and face, just ask them, why are you here, you know? And yeah,
we won Best Live Bands, and of course we are very, very happy for this. Very thankful, and this year especially, because we shot our DVD in London in January 19th. So this closes the cycle.
That's the result.
Yeah.
Why do you think for the community it's so special to have nights like tonight where we celebrate the unique magic of metal?
Well, I think it's a lifestyle. It's cool because when you see someone who listens to metal, you immediately recognize it. Like you see it from the look, from the attitude. And I think it's great that music connects so many people together.
Tonight we're celebrating some of the icons of the genre, particularly Ozzy. Are there people that mean the most to you, people who inspired you on that journey and sparked that passion that you guys now clearly have yourselves?
I would say that Type O Negative was one of the bands that got us into the genre, especially in the darker side of metal. But also Ozzy, we have to thank him because he got us on Ozzfest twice, 2004, 2006, and that was make a big difference for us, especially on the North American market, for becoming a more international band. So that helped us a lot in many ways.
I mean, it feels great. Obviously, you know, we got influenced by other bands, and now new bands are influenced by the past. In our case, we are the past, but we are the present as well. And that makes us even more happy, because we know that there are a lot of bands that are taking inspiration from us, and we are still keeping on influencing them, which is great. always look at myself as a member of the band. I don't really like to separate myself like, oh, I'm the woman in the business, because I know that it was something very weird in the beginning, because metal was just like a male-dominated scene, but now it's more open and now things have changed. But I've always looked at myself as one of the guys as well.
Is playing in the UK particularly special to you?
It is. I mean, London was one of the very, very first shows we've ever played, like 20 years ago, in our very first tour, even before our first record came out. And the support we got was amazing. I mean, we had the strongest basis of fans. They're so loyal. Most of them became friends with us. So it's like coming back home, because we feel so well here. We're so well accepted and supported. Feels great.
What do you think the future of metal is?
It depends, because I mean, I think it will keep on evolving, but evolving doesn't mean that it's not going to be a little backward as well. We were in the car coming to the award, talking about the fact that vinyls are coming back now. So it's all a cycle, you know. There is nothing really, really new. I like the fact that things are combining and changing and still getting fresh. But at the same time, I don't think that anybody invented something new. It's just, it will be just like a joining forces and evolving.
Until the attitude will be there, metal will be there, you know, because people need that lifestyle, need that breaking the law, breaking the rules, you know. So I think until that spirit will be there, with festivals, with people going to the pub and enjoying and talking about music, that will always be there, and people will always want to have that different space, you know, than normal life. You know?
I think it's always important to be who you are, you know, regardless it's metal or not. I mean, to be honest and true 100% was always our priority. And I think this is one of the things that kept us in the scene for so long, because we've always been honest with our fans. We always put out stuff that we really liked, because that's the only way to really share what you feel with people and to get connected with people.
Do you have a message for all of those many, many fans out there who love and support you and can't wait to see what you do next?
Well, we always thank them so much, because we owe them everything, but today we have even more thanks to give to them. Thank you so much. We love you all.
And stay strong. Stay strong. Thank you guys.
I was very pleased with our choreography and the dance moves. We spent a lot of time on it, and I have a lot of blisters on my footsies to attest to that. So we take a lot of passion in our dance. That's all I'm going to say.
20-minute guitar solo, most of it in the crowd with your guitar behind your head, is some doing.
The music business isn't what it used to be. That's me going out taking drink orders, and I got to make sure everybody's taken care of. So that's about it. No, but I enjoy doing it.
Celebrating, I guess, the spirit of metal. Can you talk about, for you, what this genre means and why it is so special that we celebrate it the way we are here tonight?
Well, for me, I mean, the spirit of metal, I mean, it was berserking and drinking as much as you possibly can and waking up with your pants around your ankles, and then the fellas just tell you, we had an awesome time last night. You know? But now that I don't drink anymore and I sniff glue and eat paint chips, the results are astoundingly the same. I wake up with my pants around my ankles and all the fellas say, Zachy, we had a wonderful time last night. It was awesome. Or else they hand me a grocery list of people I have to apologize to. So, you know, but aside of that, it's always a good time.
Of course, tonight, Ozzy receiving the Golden God Award. I don't think we've really seen a more fitting winner. There couldn't be a more fitting winner. Can you talk about why Ozzy is still such an important figure for the genre and what makes him such a timeless and special artist?
I just think it's great that people are finally, you know, taking notice and honoring all his achievements aside of music, like the, you know, his Wimbledon championship wins, his time with, Manchester United when they retired his number. And then after that, obviously, you know, when he struck Olympic gold in 1968 for England and won in the men's gymnastics the gold medal. So a lot of people don't really talk about that much, you know what I mean? It's always usually the music, you know? So I think it's really great we're honoring that tonight. he's not drinking anymore either, and it's the paint chips, the glue, and steroids. That's what it is. So it seems to be working.
Yeah,
cool. So, yeah. But like you said, we don't really remember much of the show last night either. So, you know, it's just...
After your stint with Ozzy, will you be going back to Black Label again? Is there a new album in the pipeline? Have you got anything lined up for anything new, Black Label?
I mean, obviously, Black Label, we're going to be, you know, in between Rolling with the Boss, then we do Black Label. And then, you know, people are always asking, I'm just like, well, what's the game plan after this, after no more tours? And I, like, Zach, is this the end? I go, no, it's not the end. I guess it's the end of Oz's solo career. But, like, right after that, Oz is going to be the new lead singer in Zach Sabbath, because we think that's like, he's kind of familiar with the material, and it won't be that much of a jump, you know what I mean? So, you know, we'll just slide right into that. Yeah, exactly. It's all for the love of the music and the glue and the paint chips.
When you look to the future of metal, obviously it's being pulled in a lot of different directions. The industry is changing. What do you see as the future of the genre?
I mean, hopefully it's better than how I'm doing. I'm 51 and I still live in my parents' basement, and otherwise I live on my girlfriend's couch. So hopefully it'll be a little bit brighter than that. But no, I think music, it's always been changing since the beginning, since when it started with Elvis and Chuck Berry and everybody. You know, I mean, it's just, it's always evolving and just, it's changing all the time. You know what I mean? I mean, which is awesome. I mean, all of us as fans of just music in general. I mean, how it just mutates and evolves into where it's at right now, 2018. So, I don't think you can predict where it's going to go. Because, you know, I mean, it'd be like saying during when Chuck Berry, you guys see, you know, can you foresee Jimi Hendrix and can you see Led Zeppelin and Black Sabbath and Cream and, you know, like all this other thing, you know. But that's where it evolved to, you know what I mean? And then it just kept moving. But, I mean, the whole thing is, but I think that's what the great thing is about music, though.
This is very overwhelming for me because I've been reading Metal Hammer for my whole life. Pretty much, and to get an award for like being alive is really weird. Like, not for nothing, it's like I didn't release an album, I didn't do anything, so this is really, really surreal. And also my man got an award and he played tonight, so that's also really nice.
When did you find out you were going to receive the award?
Last minute, couple weeks ago, and we tried to figure everything out. I'm supposed to be like on vacation at home. And they're like, hey, so we were thinking that we would like to give you this award. Like, wow. The one you gave to Darth Vader. Yeah, sure. I can handle that, I guess.
Tonight we're celebrating the metal genre, and you're obviously someone who has that lifelong passion for it. Can you articulate what the true spirit of metal is for you?
The spirit of metal. Let's not talk about anyone that plays metal or does metal or plays an instrument. The spirit of metal is just doing whatever your heart tells you to do, not caring about what other people are going to think. Oh no, I don't fit in this crowd. That's fine. The spirit of metal doesn't care about other people. You follow your gut instinct, what your spirit tells you, and you go for it. And you're not afraid. It's something about not having fear. No doors are in your way. No walls are in your way. No opinions are in your way. You just do what you need to do. And I think that is the spirit of metal. I'm sorry. This is just so, it's like super surreal for me.
Music's such a big part of your life, but then with acting as well. Can you talk about juggling so much success in so many different areas of your life right now?
It is so hard. It is really hard. But somehow, you know, where there's a will, there's a way. So paths clear out. I've been playing music since I was 2 years old. Music is my first language. But then something happened. I'm a classical violinist. My hands stopped working. So I gave up my whole childhood to play this instrument. One day I couldn't feel the instrument anymore. So another door opens and says, why don't you try acting? So you can still let out those feelings in another way, a persona. And then I found that I could still write music for other people. I could sing now instead of using my hands, or I could play a bigger instrument that's not a violin. I could play a guitar instead of a violin, or I could play a bass instead of a violin. I think the spirit of metal is also finding other solutions for things that don't seem obviously, you know, there's a wall in front of you. So the spirit of metal is like kick down that wall, right? Kick down that wall and make your own rules, make your own way.
Being part of a show that means as much to so many people as you are, does that bring, I guess, a different fan base to perhaps your music? It's, I mean, for a lot of people, you're an intro to metal for them.
There have been many times that I have seen people come to our shows because they're expecting to see Maria from Orange is the New Black. And then they are completely, I don't know if it's horrified or terrified, but there's a moment that I come out and they're like, Maria! And then they just go, no. So a lot of them are not expecting that. So a lot of them, this is the intro for them for metal, because they really want to see the character on the stage, but that's not me, that's my character. But at the same time, the lyrics resonate with them, the music resonates with them, the passion resonates with them, and it's something, an avenue that they've never explored before. So now you see people that have never been around metal in any way suddenly going to metal shows, and they really, really love it. So I think it's, sorry, I think it's really cool.
That you went to, who did you see?
My first gig that I went to, like a big stadium show, Guns N' Roses.
Were you prepared?
I was absolutely prepared, but my mom wasn't, because my mom was a chaperone and brought three teenage girls and wasn't expecting the jumbotron of boobs. Well, Alekhine's Gun is putting out a new record. Brujeria, that band that has some people that wear masks, is also touring a lot in Europe and probably in the next few weeks. It would be great if I knew who was in that band. I love that band a lot. I follow them around sometimes. You know.
Who are your biggest influences in metal?
In metal? I will say Bach. Johann Sebastian Bach. Mendelssohn. The Haunted. Meshuggah. King Diamond, Metallica, Burn, Cro-Mags, Bad Brains. Was that enough?
We've had the top, Jessica. You're going to have to finish.
I can finish? No, not yet. At the Gates, and who else? No, that's enough for a Slayer. Did we get it all? Did we get them all?
There's a cliche that metal is quite a male-dominated space. When you see all of the wonderful women who are leading lights in that genre now, do you feel like that's changing?
There's seven of us. We all have each other's number. No, it is changing. It is changing finally. It is quite a male-dominated space or male-dominated genre. But at the same time, I think we're getting to a point that now we know that we don't have to hold jackets anymore. You know, I don't have to take pictures of you anymore. I don't have to hold your jacket. You could, if you want to play that guitar, you play that guitar. If you feel, if it's moving you, just do it. Because let me tell you the big secret. A lot of these guys, they seem to be like, they know everything, right? But a lot of them, they don't even know how to tune their guitars. And we all have to learn the same way. And I think a lot of us are intimidated by it because we're taught these gender roles. But once you see these women starting to kick down those gender roles, you'll see more and more girls coming up and saying, okay, well, maybe I can't tune my guitar either, but I can play the heck out of my instrument when it's time to go, because I'm coming from the heart. And at the end of the day, that's all that matters, is that you come from the heart. Even if you have one string on a six-string guitar, as long as you come from the heart, that's all that's going to matter. And that's metal. If you come from the heart, do everything with all your heart,